they're going to make sure they do what they're supposed to do. You hear me, world? I want y'all to view this shit.
Go ahead and step out of the car for me.
What's the cause of that?
I'll explain in just a minute. Let me get
Huh? What's going on? Huh?
It's alright.
Hello? Well, I'm not consenting to nobody searching my car, even though it ain't nothing in here. I don't have no gang affiliation. Alerts about what?
We have the right to do a protective sweep.
No, you.
Yeah, we do.
Not for no search and seize, not for nothing. Okay, that's cool. But at the same time,
step out for me.
At the same time, listen, you're not supposed to open my door.
Okay. Step out for me.
You're not supposed to open my door.
Well, let me tell you this. You're just escalating things because
I'm not escalating anything. I can ask for a supervisor if I want to.
You can.
Because technically, y'all not supposed to search my car for no traffic infraction.
We're not searching. We're just doing a protective sweep.
What is a protective sweep? I'm not a gang member.
Okay. Did anybody here say that you're a gang member?
He just did.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, step out of the car so we can patch it in.
I don't mind stepping out of the car, but you know what?
All right. Well, if you want a supervisor here, I'll get one started this way.
Well, I wish you would.
I will.
Because, okay. I'm going to apply under duress because I feel like I'm being, y'all getting a little too aggressive with me.
Okay.
So I'm just going to let y'all know.
Put your hands on back of your head for me.
Y'all just told him the car.
Oop. Hang on. We're going to set this down, okay?
Technically, y'all not supposed to pat me down or go on my car.
Okay.
Whether y'all doing a search and
kick feet out.
If that's the case, then y'all, basically what y'all doing is y'all picking out who y'all want to, because there's 1,000 cars going up and down the street. Y'all pulled either one of them over. Y'all seen two young black men driving, and y'all chose to pull them over.
Shots fired right where you're coming from.
All right, go ahead and step back here.
Shots fired? Yeah.
Well, it wasn't us.
Hey, grab your smoke, man. Eight keys. Here you go.
Where's my smoke?
Right here. Oh, watch out. Don't crush it.
Sorry, y'all.
All right, Harry, are you going to be the second speed?
Yeah.
How does this standard get applied today? Normally, it's state Supreme Courts that are asked to define probable cause. Somebody's been arrested, and the court is asked to exclude that evidence because they say the police officers committed an unreasonable search and seizure. It was not based on probable cause. They didn't have enough reason. And so the court has to decide, well, what is probable cause, and did they have enough here? Along the way, they describe probable cause in terms very much like Brenniger. They often quote Brenniger and use the language we've already talked about as their starting point. So we get standard formulations like this. I'll read from a standard kind of mainstream definition, this one from South Dakota. The court says we need facts and circumstances such that a reasonably prudent person would conclude that an offense has been or is being committed. And if it's a search for property, you'd also say, and the property exists at the place designated. And you have to decide, and you have to make that determination, quote, to a probability. So you got to have some significant, substantial probability that a crime has been or is being committed, and therefore we can justify an arrest or a search for evidence of that crime. That's the kind of formulation that you often see. That's kind of the standard, the mainstream definition. There are some variations on that theme. So there are some states that emphasize that the person evaluating the claim is a magistrate, a judicial officer, somebody who sees a lot of these cases and can bring some expertise to the case and might see some significance in some small facts that others might not see. Other states will emphasize that the person making the presentation is an expert police officer, somebody who has learned over time the meaning of small cues in conduct, and therefore we can put some extra weight in the fact that the police officers found it to be suspicious. So we'll see that kind of discussion of police expertise in a number of these cases.
We're standing in front of Independence Hall in Philadelphia. This is where America was born. In 1776, the Continental Congress met here, and Thomas Jefferson drafted the Declaration of Independence. Congress approved it on July 4th, and that was the beginning of the American nation. Of course, that didn't take us all the way to where we are today. After the Declaration came the Revolutionary War, and after that, the Articles of Confederation, our first failed attempt at a national government. And in 1787, delegates from 12 states met again at Independence Hall to propose revisions to the Articles. What emerged, after months of secret deliberation, was the Constitution.
I want to ask you something.
Yeah.
You know, we're constantly being pulled over and harassed and stuff like that.
Sure.
Do you have a phone number or anything that if, you know, it's kind of a part of what we're dealing with?
Right.
You could save that for us or send it to us?
Well, I have a YouTube channel. I could send it to you. If you have a cell phone or a Facebook account, I could send it to you right away as soon as I create the video.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So you have a Facebook account.
I have a Facebook account, but more importantly, I have a YouTube channel.
A YouTube channel.
Yeah.
What is your, can I get that from you?
Of course.
All right.
Yeah, my name is Andre. And
A-N-D-R-E?
A-N-D-R-E-I.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And so my YouTube channel is four words, Horizon City News Service.
Yes, I'm trying to get in touch with the records department.
This is.
Hi, I'd like to send a records request by email. Is there an email address I can get?
You have to come in because there's a fee for it.
Fee for a records request?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
Copy of a report?
Actually, this is for an affidavit.
Affidavit for what?
For a warrant.
We don't do that here.
Well, there was a warrant that was issued by a judge to the Fort Worth Police, the Fort Wayne Police Department.
But we don't do affidavits here. I can send you back to our supervisor, and you can talk to her. Hold on a moment for me.
Okay.
Police records, this is Chris. Can I help you?
Yes, I'm trying to get a copy of the probable cause affidavit for a search warrant.
Okay, and when did this all take place?
Back on September 20th, I have the control number.
Okay, well, that's going to have to be subpoenaed.
Subpoenaed?
I mean,
I thought it's already public information.
That's not public information.
A search warrant?
Uh-uh.
A search warrant should automatically be public information.
And why is that?
Well, because when a search warrant...
It's part of an investigation, and if a case is considered investigatory, it's not public.
Okay, well, I was assuming that this particular search warrant, that there was no further investigation because the search has already been concluded.
Okay, what's the case number, and who are you?
My name is Andre, and I have the control number for this search warrant.
Okay, go ahead.
All right, 19, S is in Frank, 116, 017.
I don't even have access to that report.
All right.
So that definitely means you're going to have it subpoenaed.
You're saying that you don't have access to it because it's in some sort of secret file or something, or?
Well, when I don't have access to something, then they have it sealed. So you're going to have to get a subpoena for that.
Okay.
Okay?
No. You,
yeah, we do.
Not for no search and seize, not for nothing. Okay, that's cool. But at the same time, listen, you're not supposed to open my door.
Okay. Step out for me.
You're not supposed to open my door.
Well, let me tell you this. You're just escalating things because...
I'm not escalating anything. I can ask for a supervisor if I want to.
You can.
Because technically, y'all not supposed to search my car for no traffic infraction.
We're not searching. We're just going to protect the suite.
What is a protect the suite? I'm not a gang member.
Okay. Did anybody here say that you're a gang member?
He just did.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, step out of the car, supervisor.
I don't mind stepping out of the car, but you know what? Well, I wish you would.
I will.
Because, I mean, I'm going to apply under duress because I feel like I'm being, y'all getting a little too aggressive with me.
Okay.
So I'm just going to let y'all know.
Put your hands on the back of your head for me.
Y'all just told him the car.
As Indiana's public access counselor, Attorney Luke Britt spends his days trying to ensure state and local officials follow laws that require government to do its business openly, often. That means educating elected officials and bureaucrats about public records and open meetings requirements. Sometimes, it's mediating disputes between the media or members of the public and a jail or city council. Other times, it's writing formal opinions that set precedents local officials are expected to follow. IBJ asked Jerry Lanoska, an assistant journalism professor at Indiana University and board member of the Indiana Coalition for Open Government, to talk with Britt to the power of, who came to the job in 2013 to the power of, about the state's laws and how well officials do complying with them.
I found a discrepancy on a particular document that I just wanted to discuss with someone.
What document?
It was a search warrant.
Okay. So, is your... I'm trying to figure out who you need to talk to. Do you have an issue with the officers that did the search, or?
In a way, I do, because there was something that I believe should have been done that was not done. But I don't need to speak to them directly. If I could just speak to someone like a sergeant, a lieutenant, a captain, somebody like that.
Let me see if I have anybody available in internal affairs. Hold on just a second.
Thank you.
Sir?
Yes.
Sergeant Johnson is in, but he's not in his office right at the moment. Can I put you into his voicemail and he can call you back?
Sure. I mean, I can wait.
Okay, hold on just a second.
Okay.
Amanda Johnson is not available. Please leave a message after the tone. When you are finished, you may hang up or press 1 for special options.
Hi, my name is Andre. I wanted to contact the Fort Wayne, Indiana Police Department regarding a search warrant, which was executed on September 20th, 2019. The control number for this search warrant, the Fort Wayne Police Department control number is 19F116017. Again, that's 19F116017. That search warrant was a search warrant for a vehicle that was owned by William Roy Darnell Britt. It was a 2010 Lexus sedan. It was gray, a gray Lexus, 2010. And again, the search warrant was executed on September 20th, 2019. The reason I wanted to leave you this voicemail is I want to let you know that this particular search warrant did not have the signature of an Indiana police officer on it. I'm assuming that would be a Fort Wayne police officer, but I guess it could be any Indiana police officer that was executing the warrant. But anyway, the reason I bring that up is because I was looking at a particular code in the Indiana rules of criminal procedure. I don't know if that's exactly how you say it, but anyway, it's the statutes that deal with criminal procedure in Indiana. And in Indiana Code 35-33-5-3, there's a particular statute that deals with the form for a search warrant. And at the very bottom of that form, it specifically says signature of law enforcement officer, which is underneath where the signature for the judge and the execution date is entered by the judge. And on the search warrant that I just mentioned, with the control number of the Fort Wayne Police Department control number of 19F116017, that particular search warrant that was done on that Lexus on September 20th, again, it did not have the signature of a Fort Wayne Police Department officer or any Indiana police officer. So I just want to let you know that, and that I feel that that's a discrepancy, and I want to see what your response is to this issue that I'm bringing up. All right. There's some other issues I have regarding this search warrant. I had some questions for you or whoever I could speak to about the search warrant. There's some other information I'm looking for regarding this warrant.
Now, secondly, after if Luke Britt does give his response, whenever he does, then if they refuse to give it to you at that point, then you can file a lawsuit and they must pay your attorney fees.
Right.
Because based on Luke Britt, the courts almost 100% of the time agree with Luke Britt. And see, he's a Republican, or he was appointed by the Republican governor, I think it was. But I have found him very fair. And I've worked with him a lot myself. And if he told you to go ahead and submit the complaint and that he would give a pretty quick ruling, then that tells me that he's on board and you will get that ruling from him, I'm pretty sure. But in the meantime, if you talk to them and say, look, I'm calling as a courtesy, but I want you to know that in a telephone call I had with Luke Britt himself, he's the public access counselor, that he told me that there is no exception, that this is a public record, especially since the search warrant has already been served, and that is no longer a document that can be deemed confidential. That might just go ahead and shake it loose for you.
Exactly, and I hope that that's what happened, and I hope that it's that easy, but another side of me is thinking, I have no proof of this, but I just have this gut feeling that there's a coin flip, that this probable cause affidavit that both you and I are talking and debating about, I'm wondering if it even exists at all.
Well, they would have to, in order to get a search warrant, I've never heard of a situation, well, I mean, I've never heard of that happening, but on the other hand, in other words, they would have to fake a search warrant can only be issued on the basis of a probable cause affidavit in Indiana. So I have a gut feel that I think what they're trying to do is hide some information that's in the probable cause affidavit because they don't want this guy, whoever it is, knowing what information they have, which sounds stupid, but I mean that may be the crest of it.
I hate to interrupt, sir, but if that was the case, why would they give me, and I'm talking about a lot of information here, why would they give me 29 pages of information, way more than I ever asked for? They handed me a mountain of information. And then when I dug through all of that, there was no probable cause affidavit, which really led me to believe, I'm like, does this thing even exist?
With that, actually, you know what, I'm going to stop there, and I'm going to turn the mic over to Mr. Grace.
Thank you. Again, thanks for having me this afternoon. It's a real privilege to be part of this discussion. Part of the process of improving transparency and openness for government. Rule number one of public speaking is not to read anything to your audience, so I'm going to read something to you right now. This comes from the Indiana General Assembly in 1983. And this is my daily affirmation, if you will. Every day when I come into the office, I honestly do read this. It's right next to my one-a-day calendar. It's the preamble to the Access to Public Records Act. And the General Assembly did me a favor in setting me up as to how to do my job and what perspective to take when I make my decisions as public access counselor. They did me a favor by putting the intent of the law right there in the statute. And I want to read this to you, and I really want to have you think about these words and realize that these were written by the legislature, by a public agency, which I think is subject to the Access to Public Records Act. They disagree, but I'm working on that. But just think about this and how it ties into our discussion this afternoon. A fundamental philosophy of the American constitutional form of representative government is that the government is a servant of the people and not their master. Accordingly, it is the public policy of the state that all persons are entitled to full and complete information regarding the affairs of government and the official acts of those who represent them as public officials and employees. Providing persons with the information is an essential function of a representative government and an integral part of the routine duties of public officials and employees, whose duty it is to provide the information.
In Indiana, we have something called a public access counselor, and possibly that may be an angle for you as well.
Okay, and I have done a little bit of research into that agency or organization, but from what I've seen, they seem to be like just a shell of an organization. They have no actual power.
Well, that is true, but in theory, they're supposed to be making recommendations to those people about whether they're supposed to give you the stuff or not. So there isn't a lot of teeth, but there's a little bit of process there.
Right. Okay.
I appreciate your call. Thank you very much for trying us, and I'm sure Lisa would be happy to hear from you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you for your time, sir. Thank you.
Take care. Bye bye.
Yep. Bye.
I think those words mean something. And when I present to public officials, when I write my opinions, that's the perspective I take, is that it is our right, myself included, as a public official, to allow access, to grant access to information. I get public records requests all the time, just like any other public agency. And that's the philosophy I take. One of transparency, one of access, one of efficiency when it comes to responding to access requests. So what I'm trying to do, and I hope this is evident in my work and the work of my colleagues, is to create that ethos of openness. I like that phrase, I'm going to steal that. But I think that's what these words speak to. And so when we're talking about governments voluntarily placing data and information online, I think that's a giant step forward in achieving that ethos of openness. Auditor Crouch made a good point in her opening remarks, is that transparency leads to accountability. And I think accountability leads to better government. And opacity with information breeds, naturally and justifiably so, suspicion and questions as to what our representative officials are doing with our money. And I've heard Auditor Crouch use the expression before about every dollar should be spent with mindfulness. And I believe that's true, and I think that is a great way to put that accountability. A lot of times when I talk to public officials, and I fall into this trap as well, I'm guilty of it myself, But the fact that we know more, because we have insider knowledge to this information as public officials, because we know more, sometimes we fall into the trap of saying, well, maybe we know better. And that's not the case. Without input from our constituency, without input from the public, without input from the media, without that scrutiny, then we don't truly know better. And we can't have the tool, and we don't have the tools to do our jobs better. When it comes to placing information online, my office is subject to key performance indicators and metrics set by the Office of Management and Budget. And a couple things that I hear over and over when it comes to granting access, and this is on the state level and on the local level, and I empathize somewhat to this. Sometimes it's inconvenient to do that. Sometimes it's uncomfortable to give this information, especially if there's a shortcoming in what I'm doing in my job. That's uncomfortable to put online, to disclose, to release in an email. But again, if I do that, and if I am truly open with what I am doing as a government official, as a public employee, as a servant of the people, a civil servant, then that input that invites, the scrutiny that invites, makes me a better public employee, a better public official. I try my best to preach that to my colleagues, to other public officials, and I think by and large it rings true and it doesn't fall on deaf ears, and I'm very encouraged by that.
Sorry about that. Yes, I was calling because I was trying to begin a complaint against a Indiana government agency that's trying to deny me records. I don't feel it's legitimate.
Okay. You came to the right place. We handle that. We have a complaint form on our website that you'll need to fill out and attach any supplemental material that establishes a paper trail for the request and denial if you have anything from the agency. But can you tell me a little bit more about what you're looking for?
Yes, sir. I'm trying to get a probable cause affidavit related to a search warrant that's already been executed. And
okay.
This search warrant was executed in Allen County, Indiana, in the Fort Wayne area. And the judicial branch, the court system, the Allen County court system, the clerk's office is saying that I can't get my hands on the probable cause affidavit simply for the mere fact that it has been categorized as a separate case than the criminal case it's related to, and that based on that alone, that makes it confidential.
Yeah, I've heard this argument before, and to me, it holds no merit. I've kind of gone back and forth a little bit with Allen County's court administrator on issues like these, and some other counties have opened up miscellaneous cases trying to say this is confidential, but search warrants, and especially after they're effectuated, I mean, those have to be public. Otherwise, we've got basically secret police running around and searching for, you've got Fourth Amendment implications here. So I don't mean to preach to you or lecture you, but I empathize with your case. So I'd definitely be willing to entertain a complaint about this stuff.
Okay, great. Yeah, because you're not the only person who has pretty much said the same thing in so many words. As soon as I told them probable cause affidavit, and that's all I want, like, you know, other people, like I've called a newspaper, and they immediately said, well, that should be public. And I was like, yeah, exactly, but nobody is giving it to me, so.
Yeah. So have you talked to John McGauley? Is that who is denying you the records?
No, I'm not familiar with that name. It's actually a woman. I'll have to look up her name on the email. I think it's Andrea or something like that.
Okay.
But, yeah, she's the one who's been emailing me back. Supposedly she's the records clerk or manager. And, that's what I've been corresponding with.
Yeah. Send that our way. You can find those. Just Google Indiana Public Access Counselor. The complaint form's right there front and center on our website. Like I said, submit any materials that might be relevant, and we'll take it from there.
Okay. Actually, in regards to materials, I have a it's been like a running email battle back and forth between me and this lady. Her name I'm looking at right now is Andera Griffin, the records manager. So, I mean, I have all the correspondence in email that I could send to you guys.
Yep, that's great. That works.
Okay, so I guess at this point I'll just have to fill out the complaint form, like you said.
Yeah, and then send it away. You can email it, fax it, or send it by U.S. mail. And like I said, we'll take it from there. We have to get a response from Fort Wayne, the judicial branch up there, and then we'll take it from there.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for taking my call, Mr. Britt, and I'll be in touch.
Sure, no problem. Take care.
Yep. Goodbye.
Police Department, search warrant! Police Department, search warrant!
There's a lot of talk about search warrants and government power, what can they do, what they can't do. Hold the light here so it doesn't keep blinking. The thing about a search warrant is people think there's this mystery about a search warrant, and it's hard, and cops don't get them because they're so difficult, or, you know, if they do something without a search warrant, it's not right. Or here's the theory behind a search warrant. Now, there's a lot of cops that will do their whole career and never write one search warrant. They're not that common. Very few cops write search warrants. Very few write multiple search warrants. I've written easy 200 to 300, if not closer to 500 search warrants. I would write 2 or 3 search warrants in one day sometime. There's a mystery even among cops with a search warrant. And a search warrant is very simple. It's not that mysterious. The reason cops don't get it is it's an inconvenient, or they don't know how to do it. It's a little bit of trouble. They've never done one. Nobody around has the experience, so they normally don't do it. Working with the DA's office, we would get cases, and if you have a search warrant, it makes it easier to prosecute the case. Why? If I do something as a cop, and I search, arrest, do anything, I have to justify everything I did to a higher level than if I get a search warrant. Because when I get a search warrant, basically what I do is, instead of just doing what I do and then justifying it later and have to justify it, when I get a search warrant, I basically write down why I want to do, why I think I should be able to do it. I have a judge read it, and the judge goes, yeah, okay, I think you're right. He signs off. As soon as the judge signs the warrant, now all the responsibility for me justifying what I did switches to the judge. It switches to the defense now. They have to fight the warrant. It's called quash. A lot of people say squash. I used to say squash too. Quash is some legal term to suppress or to remove. So they quash the warrant. They have to do a motion to quash that warrant, and it's a very high standard. Because when you're attacking a warrant, you're kind of attacking the judge, because the judge reviewed the warrant and said it was okay. So you don't really make points by going in and telling the judge, hey, this judge didn't know what he was talking about. He's an idiot. He signed his warrant. He should have. That don't go over too well. Even if you're right, it don't go over well. So to get a warrant knocked down is very difficult. To confuse a jury and to blame the cop for everything that went around and make him justify it, have him slip up in a few words, that's very easy. So defense attorneys love it when cops don't get warrants. And most times cops don't get warrants. Prosecutors love it when cops get warrants, because it makes their job so much easier, everything they did. Now, where you can get in trouble with a warrant is if I lie, elaborate, exaggerate, add things that maybe I think is true. If I confuse the judge, or they can prove that what I put in that warrant ain't true, it's very easy to get rid of the warrant. The problem is, most defense attorneys don't ever attack the warrant because they know the odds of winning is nil to none. So they go, why sweat it? If it's a warrant, we won't mess with it. We'll attack the case some other where else. Which is what the prosecution wants, because the warrant usually gets you the evidence that they use against the guy. So what's a search warrant? The founders put in that no person, we should be secure in our homes and in ourselves, and we should be free from government intrusion unless government proves and has a judge or magistrate. A magistrate is the same as judge. If you hear the term magistrate, that means judge. If we have magistrate review that actually says, yes, I reviewed the government's case. Because remember, anytime the government does something to you, they're working against you. They're not trying to help you. When cops tell you, you know, I'm reading your rights, and if you really want to help yourself, you should talk to me. That's a flat-out lie. People, well, cops can't lie. Cops can lie. It's case law. It's proven that we can lie. They pass law that we can lie. Undercover cops lie all the time. If cops had to tell the truth, and there's some dummies out there with drugs that still think, they'll ask you, you're working undercover. Hey, man, is it true that if you're a cop, you got to tell them? I go, yeah, man, I've heard that, too. They do have to tell you. They can't lie. Are you a cop? No, I'm not a cop. Oh, okay. And they buy it. So, you know, like I say, cops, we don't catch the smart ones. So there's a rumor out there that cops can't lie. That's BS. Cops lie all the time. Not only do we lie, most of the time we lie, and it's approved that we lie. Two suspects to enhance our investigation. Not lie just for lying. Not lying to the court, not withholding evidence, not being changing things in a warrant. You cannot lie then. But when you're conducting an investigation and lying improves that investigation, or you're going after criminal act and you're doing it in a purpose of investigation, you can lie. It's legal. So cops lie all the time. So people that tell you cops can't lie, they're full of crap. All right. And yes, cops lie on the stand. You'll hear cops sometimes joke about when they have to go testify in court. They go, oh, I got to go test a lie. Sounds like testify. What they're really saying is test a lie to see if it flies or if it works. It's a play. A lot of cops use it. I don't think a lot of cops are out there lying on the stand. But to me, omission of the truth is a lie. If I don't tell you the truth, I'm lying. If you ask me a question, is it raining out? And I say that the moisture in the air was a little heavy and you might get a little wet, but I don't tell you whether it's not rain or it is, then I'm lying. You need to be honest when you're asked questions. Now, prosecution will tell the cops, I don't want this coming out. You know, I don't want you saying this. I mean, I ought to be a witness for the defense on crooked prosecutors, because believe me, I've seen a lot of tricks and there's a lot of them out there. And they work the courts, and it's very tough to catch them because cops don't want to lose your career and you don't want to go against prosecution. But prosecutors lie, and they try to get cops to lie all the time because they're not the one on the stand lying. If I can talk your dumb butt into getting on the stand and lying, and it helps my case, what do I care? If you get caught, I'll be like, man, you shouldn't lie, should have told the truth. But you told me you didn't want me to tell. No, no, I never said that. I always told you. That's why when prosecutions ask witnesses, when I met with you, isn't it true that I told you that I want you to tell the truth?
Yeah. All right. We've got a lot of audience questions here. I'm going to start in the back.
Yes, I've completed a record request with Jerry Encouragement a few months ago, and it was about the same land transaction from two public agencies, a school system and a city government, and. The school system was responsive, and the city government was impressive in not being responsive. They have a public access counselor who I began to call the public access denial counselor. And I even got an opinion from you, Mr. Britt, and still got about nothing from the city. And it was clear from the school system's response that there was plenty there. And so I guess I would like to ask Luke Britt and also Mark Nichols, strategies for getting through that stonewalling when you have a bad faith public access counselor.
Admittedly, and I see this across the state, some local governments are easier to work with than others. Some respond better to diplomacy. Some show deference to my office and my opinions and what I do. Some just don't. And my office doesn't have any kind of enforcement capability, so I can't compel them to release anything. I can't force them to do anything. Only a court can. And unfortunately, the reality is that, you know, if a public agency stonewalls you, then there's not a whole lot outside of the court system that you can do to compel them. Now, you know, I tell folks that diplomacy is the best way to go about it. It's easier to catch flies with honey, but sometimes, you know, that doesn't work either. And so, you know, I always invite complaints to my office so that I at least have somewhat of a channel that I can correspond with some of these folks and try to convince them. And using me as a facilitator or mediator for that is always a good idea as well. But sometimes there's a last resort, and the only way to compel an agency to be proactive and release information is through the court system.
Hi, this is Jerry Lenoski calling from Indiana Coalition for Open Government. How are you?
I'm good. Glad you called. How are you doing, sir?
Yeah, I listened to your message. Sounds like an interesting situation. You know, that law enforcement exception in the state law is kind of tricky. Police departments tend to get away with a lot under that, but we could take a look at the response for you if you want. I mean, we're a nonprofit organization, so we don't really get involved too much other than just kind of giving people a little bit of informal advice. I think probably what your best bet is going to be is to file a complaint with the Indiana Public Access Counselor.
Yes, I've already done that.
Oh, you did that? Okay.
Yes.
But, yeah, we'd be interested in taking a look. Would you mind sending us a copy of your request and the denial that you got?
Yeah, that's no problem. I just got the denial for the probable cause affidavit yesterday, so I can forward you that, and it'll be on an email thread, so you can go through all the past emails, because there's a bunch of emails that led up to the denial.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it seems like these probable cause affidavits are ordinarily, you know, public records, and I can't – that seems to be a pretty strong argument there. They're you know, they're not considered to be investigatory records generally because they're usually publicly filed. So that shouldn't be denied under that exception, but, you know, police agencies are always trying to get away with, you know, putting as much as they can under that. But I think you might be able to get some satisfaction from the access counselor, but yeah, we can definitely take a look. If you could send it to our general email, that would be great, because there's another gentleman who looks at that as well, named Zachary Bale, who's the president of ITOG. So the email address is info@IndianaCog, that's IndianaCog.org.
Hold on.
And then, yeah, we can take a look.
So, info.
Okay.
The at symbol.
At IndianaCog, IndianaCog.org.
There's no dot or anything like that, just IndianaCog altogether?
Yeah, that's right. IndianaCog.org. O-R-G.
Okay.
Yeah, that'd be great. Like I said, we're just a small volunteer nonprofit, so we don't really get involved in kind of helping mediate these things or anything. But we like to track issues like this, and you know, we might be able to offer some informal advice on it. Zach is pretty good at kind of negotiating these things with agencies, so he might have some insight that I don't. But
right, I mean, just so we're clear, and so that nobody is, you know, misinformed as to what I'm looking for, or what you guys are offering and all that, is that I never was trying to get you guys involved or mediate or anything like that. I just saw, and I guess this my predictions were correct, is that I saw on the website, it seemed to me like this was some sort of grassroots organization. So I was just trying to make you guys aware that.
Yeah, that's great. And that's exactly right. Yeah, I just like people to know for sure. You know, sometimes people want us to get involved on their behalf and make requests or intervene, and it's just not something we're equipped to do. But yeah, I appreciate you saying that.
No,
because we pretty much are like a tracking organization, and we try to educate the public, and sometimes we do lobbying. So this will be
right. No, and that's exactly why I contacted your organization, because I mean, I'm not going to try to make you carry my water and do my own records request. I'll do that myself, but I just feel like I've been trapped inside my head for weeks now with this story,
yeah.
And that nobody knows and nobody cares. Most people just want to go home and watch football. So if I could get, if I could just reach out to an organization like you guys, even if it's 5 years or 10 years from now, someone somewhere might reach out to your organization and hear about my story. And then they might have a similar situation so that this story doesn't just get lost in time, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it's very valuable to us, actually, especially on this particular subject, because the law enforcement, you know, there are several exceptions in the records law that are subject to, you know, really abuse by the agencies. And this is one where it's just a big loophole that, you know, agencies can drive a truck through. And so at some point, it's going to be a fight, you know, where we try to get the, you know, a better definition or get this exception sort of more restricted and limited. So the more information we have on situations like this, the more useful it'll be. So yeah, we definitely appreciate that.
Well,
so,
unfortunately, to add to what you just said, I have some more bad news for you, is that everything you just said sounds like bad news when it comes to open government and open records, but there's actually more bad news. And I'm no lawyer and I'm no scholar. I just found this out on my own recently, the hard way. But it's even worse than what you just said, because what you're saying is that there's exceptions and loopholes within the Indiana Access to Public Records Act. Now, that's just one way that there's loopholes and secrecy. Now there's a whole nother, basically, chess game, like mystery ambiguity thing going on, and that is with the court system. Because when I contacted the Allen County, Indiana court system, where I thought that I shouldn't have any problems requesting the probable cause affidavit for a search warrant that issued out of that court, they also had their own set of rules, which they apparently are the Indiana administrative rules for the court system. Now, based on those quote-unquote rules, they've created their own secret process so that they are able to hide. They hid everything to the point where even when I made a formal written request for not even the probable cause affidavit itself, just the cause number, because what they did is they removed the search warrant from the criminal complaint of the man that's in jail right now. Now, whether he's guilty or not, that's a story for another day. That's an argument for another day. I'm not arguing that. But the search warrant that got him put in jail is what I was trying to get. And that search warrant, what they did, and I'm sure this isn't the first time they've done this. It sounds like they do this routinely. That's just my gut feeling. But what they did is they filed that search warrant under a separate cause number or case number. And some of them call it cause number, some of them call it case number when I talk to different people that work in the court. But anyway, they filed it under a separate file. And then they claimed that because of that and that alone, no other reason, but just the mere fact that they categorize it under a separate case number, that makes it a super secret file that nobody can see. And then when I even requested in writing just the number of that file, just the cause number, the case number, they wouldn't even release that. They said that even that is confidential. So there's a complete, like, secret process for search warrants, at least in Allen County, Indiana, to where someone like me, just a member of the public, is not even able to access a search warrant that has already been executed. It's not like this is some search warrant that they're planning on doing later. It's already been executed. The guy was already put in jail. It's not like they're still searching for him. And then even then, they're still guarding it as like a state secret.
Right. Yeah, I'm aware of those rules of court. I think it's Rule 9, which is, once you get the courts involved, it's another layer of bureaucracy there. If you have any documents like that as well, we'd take a look at that.
It's all my emails. I have all the correspondence, so you guys will get that. But the point I'm trying to make here is there's a much bigger picture than just one random guy asking for one random search warrant. What I'm saying here is that the judicial branch and the executive branch, which is the police, that they together are creating an entire process, at least in Fort Wayne, Indiana, where police write their own search warrants in secrecy. Those search warrants are then held in the court system in secrecy, and then people are arrested on these search warrants, and no one can see what the probable cause was
or all the details about it. I mean, it's basically like living in another country. That's not how this country's supposed to work.
But
I just wanted to mention that.
Yeah.
But.
Okay. Well, yeah, send the email along, then, and we can take a look at it, and maybe we can. We'll take a look at it and see where we can go from there.
Yeah, at the very least, like I said, I'm just trying to inform. I'm not asking for any type of handouts or help or anything like that. If in the future someone wants to give me any type of advice or anything like that, I'm willing to take it. But I'm not trying to ask for your organization to step in any way. Now, through this whole phone conversation, I'm sorry, but what was your name again?
Jerry Lenoska. I'm on the board.
Okay, yeah. Great. Jerry, and I'm sorry, what was your last name?
Lenoska.
How do I spell that?
It's spelled Lanosga.
Okay. All right, Jerry. Well, I will forward you I'll start off with the denial letter, which I received yesterday from the Fort Wayne Police Department, and then I'll just, going forward from there, I'll forward you some other documents.
Okay, that sounds great. Really appreciate it, and appreciate getting in touch.
All right, have a great weekend. Thank you, sir.
All right, you too. Take care.
Yeah, bye.